Thank you very much. It's really a pleasure. I did a similar talk, I hope not too similar for those who were here last year, about this time last year. And I think this is such a great thing that Paul and Ian have done to, you know, organize this. And it's great that people come out of, you know, out of interest, out of whatever point people are at in their own inquiries into human-animal relationships. I think it's great. So I really looked forward to the chance to come back and to talk about at least one aspect of this issue. I mean, there, you know, you've had so many speakers, you will have so many others, and every single person has a different perspective and something new to bring to the party. And I'm not a scientist, I am not a politician, I have been at various times a journalist, mostly a radio journalist. I am basically, however, a writer, mostly of fiction, drama, and nonfiction that's much lighter and more kind of personal than this book. But my own developing interest in our relationships with animals and the psychology of it, which is what really fascinates me. Because I'm a writer, I see everybody as a potential character. And what motivates people as individuals is not dissimilar in some ways from what motivates the human race as a species and what motivates other animal species to do what they do. So it's not a weird departure by any means, although writing this book and doing the research, some of which, as anybody who knows anything about the history of our relationship with animals, can be a very painful thing to confront who we are in relationship to them and how we have kind of psychologically contrived it so that we sort of feel okay about that, which is the aspect of it that really interests me the most, is how we can have, which I believe to be these very conflicted relationships with animals. We have multiple relationships with different species and even with individual animals within the same species. We treat them differently. We feel differently about them, or we try to make ourselves feel differently about them depending on what we plan to do with them. And I find that whole psychological construct very fascinating. And so what I'm talking about tonight is, these are areas that I do touch on in this book, but I've sort of pulled it together to talk thematically about this notion of how we try to extract what we like to tell ourselves is willing consent from animals for the things that we do to them, of various kinds. I mean, some of the things we do to them, like having them as our companions and friends who get to, you know, come to to lectures. Whether, I mean, I don't think we're inflicting torture on these two dogs by having them there, but you know, so having them, offering them the best of our lives is one of the things we do with them. Offering them the opportunity to serve us in some, you know, quite terrible and often lethal ways is another way we deal with them. And we have to kind of work our minds around this, and I believe we have always had to do that. My interest in this, I've kind of packed around this story, which is the central myth that I talk about in this book, The Dog by the Cradle, The Serpent Beneath. It's a story that is probably familiar to a number of you, not only people who were here when I talked about this last year, but it's a familiar story that has different permutations. The basic form of this story that I read when I was about 9 or 10 years old, when I used to go to the library and get those big books of dog stories. I wasn't allowed to have a dog, so I sublimated through literature the way people often do. And one of these stories stuck in my mind in a way that some of the other stories didn't, because it's really, really different. And it's candid in ways that mostly are the stories we write about animals are mostly highly romanticized. And it's the story of the loyal guardian dog who is left, in this case, he's a greyhound. In the version I read, he's a greyhound, left by his master to guard the cradle of the master's only child, who's an infant in the cradle, while the master and his wife leave the, you know, kind of medieval manor. It's a sort of medieval tale. And they go off to have their day at the fair or wherever they're going. And shortly after their departure, a large snake, and in this story, it's important that it's a large snake, comes oozing out of, you know, between the stones of the stone wall and slithers across the stone floor toward the cradle where the baby is sleeping. The dog leaps up and attacks the snake, and they tussle. And because it's a large snake and a determined dog, it's quite a struggle. So that in the course of this struggle, furniture is overturned, including the cradle with the baby in it. It's turned upside down. And when the dog finally gains mastery over the snake and grabs it by, you know, the neck or whatever is the neck on a snake, and shakes it to death and flings it into a far corner, blood is spattered liberally around the room as well. The master, there's various versions of the story. Sometimes a servant comes in and sees this scene, but one way or another, the master and his wife are arrested on their way along the road by either a servant or by some instinct that something's wrong at home. They come home, and the master comes in, and he's greeted by this sight with this overwhelming circumstantial evidence, which is the disruption of the room, the absence of the child, the blood, and worst of all, the dog, who expects to be rewarded for this deed, comes toward him with his bloody jaws, and the master pulls his sword and kills his faithful dog. Only after the dog has been killed does he think to overturn the cradle to find the child sleeping soundly and safely underneath. Then somebody finds the carcass of the serpent behind a curtain with tooth marks, you know, clearly made by the dog. And so the terrible circumstantial evidence has been completely wrong, and the reality is something different, but it is too late. And that's the version of the story I read as a kid. And, you know, when you're a kid, you're not conditioned for stories to turn out this way. Charlotte's Web has, you know, I mean, Charlotte dies, and I found that a terrible blow when I was about 8 years old, and I still do. I think it's a wonderful book. But at least, you know, Charlotte, there's a kind of magnificence about it, and Charlotte lives on through her little spider children and so on, and saves Wilbur. This dog saves the child, but in so doing, he's dead, and it's too late, and the master is repentant. Now, as I said, this story shows up, I found later, when this story stuck in my head always. I could never find that anthology of dog stories that had the version that I originally read. But when I was thinking of doing this book, I wanted a kind of organizing myth, you know, a kind of idea around which the paradoxical relationship we have with animals, and I think there are a number of paradoxes in our relationship with them, would be exemplified by a particular story. And this was a story that came to mind. I never forgot it. And I never forgot my response as a child, which was to be horrified by and saddened by this story. And I've subsequently found, and some of you probably know the story, it's in various versions. There's a Welsh version about the faithful wolfhound named Bed Gellert, the wolfhound is Gellert, the village is Bed Gellert. And the Gellert is the dog of Llewellyn, the last prince of Wales, before the British conquered the Welsh, you know, the Middle Ages. And same story, except in this case, the child is outside and a wolf comes while Gellert is guarding the child, and the same thing happens, where somehow or other they fight, and somehow or other the carcass of this wolf is not obvious, and when Llewellyn comes back, the kid is gone, and he somehow construes his dog as having done it, and so on. Same upshot, except in the case of Llewellyn, the mythology is that he built a shrine to honor the dog. In the 19th century, in the village of Bed Gellert, a very shrewd hotel operator built a shrine, which is still there, to honor the dog, because over in Edinburgh, they built a statue to Greyfriars Bobby, the loyal little Skye Terrier who would not leave his master's grave in the churchyard. And that did bonanza things for tourism in Edinburgh. So in Bed Gellert, they realized this would be a really good tourist thing. And indeed, I think it probably is. But the idea was that it was too late to do anything but mourn the dog and mourn him properly and feel terrible about the whole thing. There are other versions, apparently, and other cultures, Greek, Indian. Yes, do you know another one? Lady and the Tramp. It's a wrap. Yes, exactly. I you know, I only noticed that when I saw Lady and the Tramp again after years and years. Again, it's the story of the Cocker Spaniel and her romance with the street dog. And in the course of it, their family has a baby, and the awful mother, or no, it's a nurse, I think, who's this kind of overbearing baby nurse who thinks the dog should be from the baby's room and is kind of excluded. However, the dog is home alone, rat into the baby's room, and the dog attacks and kills the rat with the help of Tramp, the other dog. But the evidence, again, when the nurse comes in, she doesn't realize immediately that it is about the rat. She thinks that the cocker is a baby. The idea, I mean, it's a good thing to bring up, because I'm sure the Disney people or whoever conceived the original story knew some version of this story. But it preys on the notion of that we're trusting. I mean, this man was incredibly trusting of his dog. He left the dog in sole charge of the baby. But in an instant, on a dime, that view completely alters. And suddenly the animal is seen as, you know, the wolf in dog's clothing, so to speak, that the dog is just this much layer removed from savagery, and that the dog is the kind of undertone and subtext is the dog is jealous of the baby and waited for this opportunity. And that's what must have been harbored in the guy's mind all along. There is actually a version of this story that happened in France, and it really happened in the 13th century, probably, because it was first reported reliably by a Dominican priest named Etienne or Stéphane, sometimes he's called one and sometimes the other, of Bourbon, who worked for the Pope as an inquisitor. And he was one of those guys they used to send around to villages. You know, Christianity was fairly well established, obviously, in the 13th century. Nevertheless, there are always these little pagan things cropping up that had to be like crabgrass coming up through the lawn. You know, they had to be kind of stamped out. And usually it involved some form of animal or nature worship, some kind of pantheism or paganism. And, you know, Christianity utilized some of these things, like Christmas is, you know, they took the solstice festivals that actually already went on. Easter, you know, most of the holidays in the Christian calendar are kind of pinpointed around things that already existed in the Druidic and other kinds of pagan religions. But nevertheless, this guy wrote about this because he heard about this story. And the outline of the story is very similar. Nobleman, dog, leaves the dog in charge of baby, in his absence, snake comes, the whole story, except when he comes back and erroneously kills the dog, the story goes on, because the guy is both repentant and also very frightened, because he's done something which is a kind of a transgression. He's a nobleman. Only certain noble classes were allowed to have dogs as big as greyhounds. And in fact, commoners were only allowed to have dogs of a certain size, probably more like Baby and Buddy. And they had a thing called a dog ring, sort of like a luggage sizer at the airport, you know, where you put that frame, you put your suitcase in to see if it's small enough to be overhead. And they had, if the dog could step through the ring, i.e. was low enough to the ground, the dog could be owned by a commoner, but if a tall dog, especially a hunting dog, was reserved for the nobility. So to kill, as Etienne of Bourbon wrote in this story, he wrote about it, he said, the man was afraid of the wrath of God for having killed so useful a dog. Not a sentimental story in this case, but it was a useful dog, and it was a dog who was regarded as worth preserving. So the guy, the nobleman, buried the dog. He had an abandoned well in the front of his house, and he bundled the dog into the well and planted a grove of trees, partly to kind of honor the memory of the dog and also to try to conceal the well. But in the story, and again, I mean, it's hard to know where, there probably really was a dog. However, the mythology around what happened after that is probably mixed in with a lot of local lore, which is that the master's crops fell into ruin. You know, the usual thing that happens when you transgress is you get punished, and the family was finally driven out of this manor house. They abandoned it. It was left abandoned. However, the local peasantry heard about this and came and started to bring their ailing children to the well where the body of the dog was interred, and they interceded, they asked the dog to intercede for their ill children and make them well. And they called the dog Saint Guinevere. Again, there really was a human Saint Guinevere. He was in some other part of France, and he was associated with children, but why these people chose that name, nobody really knows. And certainly when Etienne of Bourbon came, he'd heard that there was this pagan worship going on and that people were bringing their children, and they had these elaborate rituals. They were partly pagan, where they would pass the child back and forth through the branches of the tree, and they would ask the fairies who had stolen their healthy child and replaced it with a changeling, with an ailing child. That was what people believed. And they would ask the dog to intercede and, you know, and with the help of the fairies, restore the healthy child. They would immerse the child in the river. There was a river that ran through the area. This is a little town north of Lyon called Châtillon. And there is a river called the Chalaronne, which runs through it. And this is where they would immerse the children and so on. And so this started to be noticed everywhere, including in Rome. And Stefan was dispatched back into this. He didn't really know too many of the particulars when he arrived, but he knew something was going on, so he gave a sermon and said, you know, I understand that there are types of pagan worship, people worshiping elderberry trees and anthills, and, you know, and if you will come to confession and tell me about anything going on here, you won't be punished. You'll feel better. So he had a section of people, and of which was an old woman. Usually this cult, as it was called, was kind of facilitated by an old woman who would sort of lead the thing. Anyway, an old woman, whether she was involved or not, was the first person who came and told him. And she said that she was involved with people who worshiped Saint Guinevere. And he said, Stefan said, I did not know who Saint Guinevere was. I thought he must be a hermit or a holy man of some kind. I leaned, you know, like through the grating of the confessional and asked her who Saint Guinevere was, and was horrified when she told me dead dog. So this was heresy and had to be rooted out. So he didn't punish anybody, but he made the townspeople tell him where this well was, went with a party of people, and he said, we disinterred the dog, burned the dog, so there really was a dog in the well, and by now this grove of trees had grown up around the well, cut down the trees and burned them too, and then he went on his way, kind of a good day's inquisitional work done, rode off to the next town. The minute he was gone, people just continued to bring their children to the same area, whether the dog was there or not. The dog had been there, and the ritual continued. And the amazing thing about this is the ritual continued until into the Second World War. It continued for 700 years. And by the time of the book that I read, which details all of this much more elaborately than I just have, it was written by a French anthropologist named Jean-Claude Schmitt. It's a very good book. It's called The Holy Greyhound. And it's not that easy to get hold of, but nevertheless, it's you can interlibrary loan or something. I eventually got it. And he talks about the fact that he interviewed people. He did his book in the late 1970s. So this is now almost 40 years away from 1940, which is sort of the last recorded occasion where people brought their children. And he said that when he talked to people who could remember as children being brought, if they were ill, to be healed by Saint Guinevere, even in the 1930s up till 1940 anyway, people knew that Saint Guinevere was a dog. They knew the story of the dog, the cradle, the snake, the baby. The whole legend had remained completely intact all those years. So, and the reason that we know the story is because Etienne of Bourbon wrote it in 1250 AD in Latin as one of his six exempla. He wrote these things called exempla, which were kind of little sermonettes, and each was an example. Exemplum is an example of something bad. And the story of Guinefort is one of the exempla, and the way he rooted the cult. Now, he died not knowing that this carried on long beyond him. But all the detail we have about the story and about the manor house comes from him. And this guy, Jean-Claude Schmitt, did this investigation to try to find out where the house was, you know, what anything was left. And in the end, he figured out where it was. By the 1980s, which I didn't know. I didn't know about the later explorations until I actually went there. But in the 1980s, an archaeological dig was done, and they found certainly the footings of the house. They found the outline of the well, and of course no dog, because the dog was long gone, and the forest had grown and regrown numerous times. But there were layers and layers and layers of children's clothing and shoes, because part of the ritual was, you know, in passing the child back and forth, you also used objects that belonged to them and so on. There were involved rituals, and then you buried them. There are, you know, these layers of little rotting leather shoes and things, you know, from going back not as far as the 1200s, but up, you know, 1400s, 1500s. So it quite a story. And to me, that story, both in its original form, I read when I was about 9 or 10 years old, and in the deep of this particular version of it that I later learned about, to me it says so much about how we use animals, you know, as in stories or in religion or in our daily lives, as both as volunteers. I mean, the dog was, you know, left like a servant to guard the baby, and it was understood that he would willingly, you know, protect the child. But then after death, after he'd been wrongly killed, he becomes a kind of martyr who is begged to continue helping even after death, even though his death was brought about by, you know, the stupidity of man. I mean, it's very Christ-like in that way, you know, the idea of the one who dies for our sins, so to speak, and then continues to intercede on our behalf as if dying for our sins wasn't enough, you know, and that's very much the kind of that story. It's not the first example of this. The notion of using animals in sacrifice, directly in sacrifice, is a very ancient notion, obviously. It's probably one of the first forms of sacrifice. It's hard to know when humanity started using animals as sacrificial objects, and how, you know, how that developed. But certainly in ancient India, there are Vedic texts that tell us that horses, which have always been highly desirable as animals. I mean, they are beautiful and useful, but mostly I think it's this nobility and beauty of horses that makes them both ideal to be loved and also ideal to be sacrificed. I mean, sacrifices do not usually involve valueless animals. You know, it's not like a case of just, you know, cutting the head off a chicken or something. You sacrifice the best. And so the priest's job was to sacrifice the horses. And before they would cut their throats, they would say to the horse, they would have to whisper into his ear, "You do not die through this. You go on paths pleasant to go on." So it was a kind of a promise to the horse that this was about something, that the horse, and a form of kind of asking the horse's permission in a way. Now, the outcome wasn't going to ever be anything but what it was. But the idea that this was necessary. Ancient Greece, bulls were at one point, I mean, there's, you know, the history of ancient Greece is a long one, but the bull had a very large kind of symbolic importance in sacrifice. And when a bull was to be sacrificed, again, it was always the priests who did it. It wasn't lowly people. It was, you know, people who were kind of close to the deities. They would bring several bulls, because it wasn't a case of just grabbing a bull and cutting his throat. The animal had to be seen or perceived or believed to consent. So grain would be spread on the altar, and several bulls would come forward. And the bull who first went to the grain was deemed to be the one who was asking to be sacrificed. And it's a kind of mental ventriloquism, you know, where you put these words into the bull because it makes you feel better. I mean, there can be no other explanation. In Delphi, they would sprinkle like the equivalent of holy water, whatever, you know, holy water is something we associate with Catholicism, but, you know, some kind of blessed water would be sprinkled so that the animal would toss its head. And the animal who was perceived to be nodding was the one who was saying, "Let it be me." And that would be the animal that would be sacrificed. There are some even more involved and, you know, in some cases kind of terrible rituals that involve this mixture of love and cruelty. The Ainu of Japan, who are a people of northern Japan, had a ritual which is recounted in various texts, including the Golden Bough, which is this kind of concordance of mythologies that was written in late 19th century by this guy Fraser, who he made it, you know, he tried to collect every legend there was and see that there was a kind of common thread, sort of like Jung, the notion that, that there are these repeated motifs in the collective unconscious. And among the Ainu, they would, in each village, capture a bear cub, a small cub, and keep it for a couple of years as a pet. It would even be suckled by women. And, you know, just treated like a beloved baby of the village in every way. And then as it got bigger, it would be penned up and fed and fattened. And then when it was about 2 years old, it would be killed in a long and terrible ritual of torture, which I don't even want to go into. Only to say the upshot was that once the poor bear was finally dead, they would cut its head off and put it on a table where they were all eating and serve it a plate of its own entrails. While all the people in the village, and the women, while the bear was being tortured, which went on forever, women would alternately laugh and cry to sort of signify both their sorrow at what they were doing to this child of their village, but also this pleasure in the fact that this was, you know, an important sacrifice. And they would say to the bear, as they were, you know, inviting him to dine on his own entrails, go to your people, go back to the spirit world of the bears and tell them how kindly we treated you and send others of your kind. It's a common kind of refrain in many cultures. The asking up for forgiveness by the animal, the worshiping of kind of spirit versions of the animal, common in North American Native culture, and cultures all over the world. One of the first examples is in the cave bear, who was, you know, either, depending on who you believe, either Neanderthals or Cro-Magnons, but, you know, in a lot of the caves of Europe, these caves that are up to 40,000 years old, there's evidence of these arrays of bones and evidence of sacrifice of this bear. But the bear was not sacrificed, you know, just as lunch. It was a deity. It was a deity to be feared. And the way that you propitiated it and dealt with it was to kill it, at the same time asking it to send others of its kind, which is, you know, that was what was done with the buffalo and on the Western Plains in North America, too, that, you know, the idea was that you asked them to forgive you for the death of the individual, but the hope was that somehow you built up goodwill and the buffalo would continue to come, which indeed they did until white people intervened and extirpated both the buffalo and the Indians. We carry this notion, I think, of sacrifice and of the elevation and nobility of the animal, of sacrifice, and also the animal's kind of willing participation. I mean, this is key. It's not just sacrifice in the sense of, you know, it's you. It's the idea that you have to get the consent. And in the 19th century, when animals were being used more and more widely in scientific experiments, as physiology and other kinds of life sciences developed, it became clear that animals made good models, and they certainly made unresistant models. You could capture them, especially small animals, and to this day, and probably in this very building, they're animals who are, you know, dying in the service of humanity every day, or are certainly being experimented on. And in the 19th century, the realization was that this had to be ennobled somehow. It couldn't be seen either by the scientists themselves or by the world at large as a kind of brutality. It had to be seen as something noble. And so the concept of calling death of an animal in a laboratory sacrifice, where at the end of the experiment, either to do a post-mortem or to end the suffering of an animal in a terminal experiment, when they're killed, they are sacrificed. That's the terminology used. And in the 19th century, it was the term was to be sacrificed on the altar of science. So that science, you know, as it kind of came to replace religion as an important set of beliefs, took this notion of sacrifice and applied it to animals so that it wouldn't seem quite as perhaps unseemly as, you know, let's kill them at the end of it, or let's just get rid of them. All euphemisms are often employed for death, as we know. You know, the CIA and other kind of secret organizations have these terms like terminate with extreme prejudice, you know, terms like that that mean kill, you know, and so sacrifice is kind of one of those. But to go back to the story of Guinefor and how it goes in terms of kind of human psychological development, from being a story, which I read as a kid, which was very much about how awful this thing was that happened to the dog, to being a kind of centerpiece of an actual cult, is a kind of interesting journey. Like most stories about animals, it does start with children. I mean, the fact that I read this story as a child is no accident. Stories about animals are very, very common for children. They are commonly created and given to children. And when I read the story, as I look back on it now, I realized that my horror at this story was that, first of all, I identified with the dog. I mean, what kid doesn't identify with an animal? Something goes wrong and you can't explain. If the dog could have said, as the guy's coming with his sword, oh no, I see, you got it wrong. You think I killed the baby. No, the baby's over here, and the snake is over there, and, you know, I did a good thing. But the animal lacks a voice, literally. A child lacks often the ability to explain its motives or to explain the outcome. There's a lack of due process in that story that is shocking to a child, but very familiar. The idea that, you know, conviction and sentencing and carrying out of the sentence all occur simultaneously is something that children are used to when they're punished. Once it's ascertained that they did something wrong, it's, you know, whatever form the punishment takes, it's just automatic, and there's no, you know, we're not going to talk about this, you know, I don't want to hear another word, I know what you did. And also, and perhaps more importantly, most importantly for a child, lack of redress. You know, I mean, it's all well and good for Llewellyn, you know, last Prince of Wales, to build a little monument. It's all well and good for that lord in medieval France to put the body of the dog in the well and put a nice grove of trees around it. But from the dog's point of view, it's over. You know, he's dead. And he did a good thing, and his recompense for doing a good thing was to be killed. And I think children really grasp that, certainly innately, if not actually. I mean, I don't imagine when I was 9 or 10, I sort of thought it through like that. But my response was, you know, the indignation of injustice, and definitely identifying with the dog, because when you think about it, your own relationships with animals when you were children, they're very equivalent. I mean, and when you're in a household where there are pets who are treated, you know, like members of the family, not obviously not livestock, but you know, house pets, often they're about the same size as the kid. They often have a very similar role in the family. And children, I mean, I didn't distinguish when I would meet a dog or a cat when I was a little kid. I didn't sort of think, oh yeah, they're just animals and I'm an important person. It was sort of like, hi, you know, who are you? And because of language, was not the key way of communicating either for a small child or for an animal. There's this kind of kinship. And when you get older as a child, you realize that politically, you're very much on the same plane. Sometimes your stature is literally about the same height. You can't reach the things you want. And the cartoonist Al Capp, who created the cartoon strip Little Abner many, many years ago, once said, children are midgets with no money. And which I think is a very, I mean, I don't think he meant it derogatorily. I think he meant it as a political comment. And this is very much the powerlessness of children. They're short and they have no means. And animals lack stature either literally or certainly figuratively, and they have no means. So that there is this kind of political identification between children and animals. Again, I mean, children don't articulate it this way to themselves, but they instinctively sort of understand. And it's a what shocked me, as I said, as a child the most of anything was that I was not set up for unjust animal death in stories. That was not what I was conditioned to. I was conditioned to stories like Lady and the Tramp, where however dark it looks for Lady, at a certain point it all ends up with her and Tramp and a litter of puppies, you know, or having a spaghetti dinner together, you know, behind a restaurant. Or even Old Yeller, which is, you know, a very, very sad dog story where in the end he contracts rabies from having fought off a rabid wolf for the protection of his family and has to be dispatched. I mean, I think that's actually an excellent book. It's like The Yearling, which is another one where the boy raises a fawn, although the fawn is not a useful servant. In fact, the problem with having a pet deer is that it's totally destructive and completely uncontrollable. But he loves the fawn and in the end must be the one who kills it. I mean, these stories, I think, are really, really important about conditioning children to accept the inevitability of animal death and also to sometimes be the one who has to do it. But a lot of children's literature is much more positive and happy than that. And animals are presented in children's stories as characters in their own right. I mean, many children's stories have animals as their either central or only characters, or they interact freely with human beings, or if they don't talk, they're understood in other ways. I mean, the bond is very much emphasized in children's literature. So what happens to children, I think, is that they have to be kind of weaned away from this in adulthood so that they will see animals as different from themselves so that they can use them, so that they don't ask embarrassing questions about, you know, is this a cow on my plate, or the kinds of things that kids ask or say, I won't eat that, or, you know, where children don't want to see animals simply treated as commodities. So they have to be conditioned toward that. And it's very much like the childhood of humanity itself. You know, when humanity was in its infancy, as Freud points out, our relationship with the world was very much like a child's relationship, an individual child's relationship with the world, including animals. There wasn't a lot of distinction between humans and animals back in the ancient world, especially the earliest human beings who were probably vegetarian and certainly not the biggest predators on the block, if they were predators at all. And gradually, in order to gain mastery over the other animals, and they began to utilize tools and develop their brains and do all the things that we know happen through evolution, they left animals behind, in other words. And they had to, however, just as we condition children individually, come to understand that this was okay, and in fact this was right, to separate humans from other animals and to make distinctions even among animal species, between the ones that we treat one way and the ones we treat another. One of the ways we have created distinctions and helped to kind of square this circle of both having emotional attachments to animals and also utilizing them is the creation of pets. Pets literally are the thing which is spared. They are the animal that wasn't sacrificed. They are the animal who was set aside and turned into a companion, partly so that we could feel okay about killing the other ones. I mean, that is, you know, an interesting human psychology. There was a very interesting story during the foot and mouth plague that in Britain in about 15 years ago, around 2000, there was a very bad outbreak. And some of you probably old enough, many of you not, to remember these front page photos and television footage of these burning funeral pyres where all these animals had to be, you know, because they were carrying this disease, which isn't fatal. It's a disease that animals pass, and it ruins the herd, and so millions, literally millions of cows, sheep, I don't think pigs, I think just cows, sheep, goats in Britain were incinerated, and they, you know, these hoofs would be sticking up out of these funeral pyres. In the course of this, one little calf who was still alive was discovered in a group of cows who had been slaughtered and were awaiting burning on this pyre. And this little calf was made much of in the British press. She was called Phoenix because she'd almost literally risen from the flames. And she became this huge story. She was reunited with her family, with the farmer who had to take her with her mother to be slaughtered. And this became this huge human interest story. And people questioned at the time, as people always do when one animal is made so much of and millions are dead, why? You know, why was Phoenix's life important? And to people who would then, after they'd read a wonderful story about Phoenix and, you know, cried a little bit, would go and have a roast beef sandwich for lunch. You know, I mean, that kind of dissonance. But there is something, I think, that we do as human beings, which is to make one special so that we can feel okay about the millions who aren't special. And I think that's a good example of, you know, kind of how that happens. We also, when it comes to animals that we know we are going to sacrifice, like cattle, we create what Carol J. Adams, who is an animal rights and feminist philosopher, has called the appropriate victim. And she herself discovered the idea of the appropriate victim. She, when she was a girl, had a horse. Also lived in a small town where there was a slaughterhouse at the end of the road. And she would not allow her, because she loved horses so much, she wouldn't allow her mother to feed dog food to the dog that had horse meat in it. But she would walk unthinkingly, you know, past the slaughterhouse or see the animals, you know, kind of driven, like the cows and the pigs, kind of driven down the street to the slaughterhouse without even thinking about it. And have the pork chops that were on her plate without even thinking about it. And then when she was an adult, a horse of hers died and she had to dispose of the horse. And anybody who's ever had a large animal to dispose of, you know how hard that is. It's terrible to try to figure out what to do with it. Her horse was sort of lying there dead. And when she saw her dead horse, she realized that it was no different from any of these other animals. But the reason that she'd always perceived it as different was because the culture had made appropriate victims of these other animals. A horse, except in cultures where they are sacrificed, or cultures that eat horses, you know, much more readily than we do in our culture, a horse is not regarded as an appropriate victim. A horse has a different role in our lives. And so that's another way that we kind of create these distinctions that will allow us to believe that it's right the way these things happen. And the consent notion, Donald Watson, who was the person who created the word vegan, along with the idea of veganism as opposed to vegetarianism, talked about the fact that when he was a child, he would go to visit his uncle had a farm. And he said, on the farm, we were always told the cows give milk, the chickens give eggs. And he said he hadn't questioned it until he thought, I wonder what the pig gives, and then heard that pig being slaughtered in the barn, because back in those days, of course, you know, animals were killed on the farm, and realized, you know, that this is a kind of myth. The notion that it's voluntary giving is, again, something we put into this relationship so that we can feel positive about it. The notion of actual volunteerism, like literally being a volunteer, I think came to me when I went, it was in 2006, so how long ago is that now? 7 years ago, 7.5 years ago. There was an incident that happened in Toronto, which some of you might remember. where a police horse, one of the Toronto police horses, whose name was Brigadier, who was a big, the Toronto police horses are usually Belgian horses crossed with a smaller breed. So it's a large horse, it's a riding horse, but it's a big horse. He was a big kind of almost dark Palomino horse, lovely horse. And he was on patrol with his partner, as they call the rider in this case. And the cop had an interaction with a motorist. And as he didn't give him a ticket, but he kind of spoke to him about something. And as he and the horse were walking away, the guy gunned his vehicle and drove it at the horse. And twice, backed up and did it again. And in the course of the collision, the cop was thrown over the hood of the car and injured, whiplash injury. But Brigadier's both front legs were shattered, which, you know, of course, with a horse, is a broken leg is pretty likely fatal. Two broken legs is definitely fatal. And the horse was in so much pain, he was euthanized right there on, you know, Front Street or something in Toronto. And this created a huge reaction from the public. More so because when the guy was charged, he was charged for leaving the scene of an accident, and he was charged for the injuries he caused to the cop. He was not charged for having, you know, fatally injured this horse. And the cops were upset about it, because even though horses are property in our laws, the relationship was a strong relationship. And so what happened ultimately was there was a public memorial for Brigadier, which was at the Rico Coliseum down on, at the X, which is, you know, where the horse show takes place, also where the Toronto police stable their horses. So it was an appropriate place for Brigadier. And police forces from across the country, and some from the States, who had service animals, dogs or horses, brought them. And there was I was one of about 1,500 just people who went. I mean, I was interested. I was interested in this because to me it sort of said everything about, you know, this relationship. I mean, this horse was property. It wasn't even a crime to kill him, and yet it was regarded as a sin and an outrage. And the funeral was very touching. It was like if you've ever been to a police funeral. It wasn't dissimilar. It was others from other forces honoring one of their own. The dogs were all sitting, you know, like in rows, the horses, they had a little kind of march past at the end outside with the horses. And when Brigadier's rider, his partner, spoke, he still had his whiplash collar on. They had the horse's saddle under a spotlight, you know, on a podium. And they had videos of happier days when Brigadier is, you know, running around and the police, you know, the police have that kind of training area, sort of north up the Don Valley. And when he was spoken about by his rider and by Bill Blair, the chief of police, and other dignitaries, they all said he died doing what he loved. He would not, you know, it was terrible what happened to him, but he would not have had it any other way. How did they know? You know, nobody asked him, would you rather be, you know, rather be on a farm maybe somewhere, or would you like to be competing in equestrian events, or, you know, do you like, no, I like police work, oh, I love this, you know. And yet it was necessary, and these guys were completely sincere. I mean, you know, I did not regard this as hokey. I thought it was telling. And afterward, I mean, the cops, I talked to the cops afterward, because there was a little, just like at a real funeral, you know, outside Brigadier's stall, which was decorated with carrots and apples and cards from, you know, sympathy cards. The cops were quite bitter about the fact that this guy was not being charged. In fact, Ontario law has subsequently been changed. There is a law, they tried to put it through federal parliament, called Brigadier's Law. But the Liberal government failed, so all this animal legislation, along with other things, failed. But the Ontario government did pass a law where police service animals, the maiming or killing of a police service animal in the course of its duties is now regarded as, I think it's a felony. Not sure. It's a felony? Yeah. You were nodding, I thought maybe. But but of course, I mean, part of it is because they are police service animals. There's still this notion that their importance comes from their contribution to us. But this notion of volunteerism is, you know, fascinating to me. Another way I think we extract the notion of consent is that old-fashioned way they did back in the days of, you know, ancient India, sacrificing the horse, is to have a ritual around it. Temple Grandin, who is the, I think many people here probably know her, have heard her speak, either like her or not, is an advocate of humane slaughter. She has spent her entire adult life using her, what she feels is her internal understanding of animals, because she is a high-functioning autistic. She thinks like animals. She says she thinks in pictures the way she believes animals do. So she's able to design slaughter systems, anticipating the things that might be upsetting to an animal on its way to slaughter. And so she has spent her life attempting and succeeding largely in getting large food franchises like Wendy's, McDonald's, not KFC, I don't think, I mean, chickens, whole other story, but nevertheless, these companies can only buy their meat from facilities that have slaughtered them according to the prescripts that Temple Grandin has set down, her system of what she calls measurable audits, where only 1 in 100 can fall down on its way up the chute. 1 in 100 can be prodded with an electrocattle prod. I mean, there's sort of allowable level of things going wrong, but basically it has to function smoothly. They, you know, and the animal trots willingly up. She designed a circular staircase, which she calls the stairway to heaven, without any irony that I can detect. And at the end of it, the animal does not see until the moment where it is stunned with a, usually how large animals are killed is they're stunned with a captive bolt pistol, like a big leaded thing goes into their brain, which stuns them, and then their throats are cut. And then they're lifted up by a hind leg and they bleed as they go along this thing called the bleed rail. And Temple is, you know, I've heard her. I spent time with her in Colorado where she teaches. I went to her class on humane slaughter. She is very sincere. And she believes, and I, you know, you can't argue with her, that to be killed in a facility that meets her specifications is better than the slaughter that takes place in many other kinds of places, both in the United States and other places. However, there's a kind of religiosity about it that is the stairway to heaven is one thing, and she told me a story, and she's told it elsewhere too, about this group of 4-H kids who, you know the 4-H, I mean, it's puzzling. You see these kids at the Royal, you know, with their beautifully groomed heifers and goats and sheep and stuff, and clearly there's love and emotion, and yet the upshot is they usually are sold at auction, often at that very place. And she, Temple, had a group of 4-H kids take their calves, or, well, they would be bigger than calves by the time they were slaughtered, up the stairway, and so they would accompany them to slaughter. And at the end, they were allowed to see that their livers and pancreases were taken for insulin extraction so that they could help people with diabetes. And this made them feel way better. And that, you know, I mean, and it's what we do. I mean, this is very often how we deal with animals. The idea that their sacrifice is right if the objective is right and if it's done a certain way. I think a lot of the organic meat industry kind of functions on that same principle that, you know, some of us went to a film called Pig Business by a British woman who is herself has become a huge advocate for humanely raised meat because she's opposing the huge intensification of pig farming in Europe, where old facilities that were abandoned after the fall of the Soviet regime, like in places like Poland, have been bought by Smithfields, which is an enormous pork business, which I think originally began in England, but is huge in the United States. And they bought these facilities, And they're, you know, turning them into large intensive pig farms, such as what we have here. And she opposes this. But she doesn't oppose this because she doesn't want pigs killed. She wants them raised in the kind of the old-fashioned way. And her film has shots of her frying up bacon, you know, of a morning for the kids. And there was a farmer is interviewed, and he's kind of scratching the head of this nice old pig under an apple tree. And, you know, you can say, well, that's better. Better that they should live like this outside and then, you know, die in a kind of individual way, you know, in some small abattoir. I have friends who have, you know, raised sheep and small farms. They get to know them. They take them. They make sure they take them to a nice abattoir, you know, but they're, but, you know, and then they'll come back in a brown paper wrapper, you know, but it's part of, you know, certainly part of how we kind of, yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. I think it's true. It's regarded as right in some sort of, you know, divine kind of way. It is the notion of stewardship of animals, which is the Old Testament idea that Adam was given dominion or stewardship, depending on the translation you read, over the animals. The idea that, you know, with this right came responsibility, but it wasn't the responsibility, you know, to live with them as equals. It was the responsibility to make sure they were, you know, handled properly in their lives and in their death. There's another myth, I think, that we, again, a very ancient myth around animals, which is that we offer them some form of legal redress. In the Middle Ages, animals could be put on trial. There are famous cases from the Middle Ages of a family of pigs, for example, who killed somebody who, you know, wandered into the pig pen, the mother pig and her piglets. I think the mother pig was convicted and hanged, but the piglets were, you know, account was taken of their extreme youthfulness, and they were allowed to survive. But there were court-appointed lawyers to represent the animals. There's a quite amusing film. I can't remember the name of it. Colin Firth is in it. It's an early Colin Firth film, before Bridget Jones, before Pride and Prejudice, where he plays this medieval lawyer who's assigned, an advocate, who's assigned to, you know, take the case of a pig in one of these stories. So, I mean, this was true. Now, of course, it was also a way of kind of propitiating the gods. You know, you gave these animals a good defense, and if they lost and had to be executed, like human criminals, well, that's justice and that's the law. We don't do quite that anymore, but we do something similar at times when we try to. For example, a couple of years ago, there was a case in BC of sled dogs who are, you know, sled dogs are raised for these kind of recreational operations. And this outfit was losing money or going broke or something, too many dogs. And this guy was assigned to simply kill a whole bunch of them. And he did a very bad job of it and buried them. And after shooting them and hacking them, and, you know, 100 or so dogs were just dispatched. And the guy had a nervous breakdown. And the only reason we know the story was because he filed for workers' compensation. But it became a huge story, you know, an inquiry or task force was appointed a couple of years ago to go over this case and to give recommendations, just as it would be with a coroner's jury or any other thing that involves humans. And a guy in the Vancouver Sun at the time, a guy named Stephen Hume, because this was in BC that this happened, wrote about this, and he said, "We're upset about the massacre of sled dogs, but by the time you finish reading this column, close to 20,000 farm animals will have been slaughtered nationwide, according to Canadian Meat Council statistics. Why do we rise up in collective wrath over something like the appalling incident at Whistler while shrugging off the inhumane and unethical treatment of so many other animals?" Well, I got into a correspondence with him over this. I thought he made a good point. And I thought, and my feeling was, that the difference here is it's the manner of death and it's who's dying. You know, we again, it's the appropriate victim. We don't see sled dogs as appropriate victims. We see them as service animals and companions. The idea of 100 of them being killed at a time is different to us than 100 or 1,000 or 1,000,000 cattle being slaughtered in a slaughter facility. And we've created those distinctions so that we can feel okay about both of these species. I think the media has done enormous service in the last century and more recently in keeping this kind of mythology going that animals are volunteers. When I was a kid, you know, carnation milk came from contented cows. That was the slogan. There was the Borden cows as well, Elsie and Elmer, and the Borden cow and the Borden bull. And they were these kind of nice cows who wanted nothing more than that you should have their products. Please, you know, have some cheese, have some milk. I think the apotheosis of this was in the 1960s and 70s was a commercial for Starkist tuna with Charlie the tuna. And again, only the elderly among us, myself especially, will remember Charlie the tuna. But it was striking even at the time. It was a cartoon of a tuna. And the shtick was that Starkist wanted tuna with good that tasted good, but Charlie understood that to mean tuna with good tastes. So he constantly tried to prove to the Starkist people, he's under the ocean, that he has good taste. So he recites poetry in one commercial. He has a beatnik hat and bongo drums in another. He tries to show, you know, he's kind of an exemplar of good taste. Each time a hook with a line comes down with a little note attached that says, "Sorry, Charlie, better luck next time." And Charlie is disappointed. He's not going to be caught and, you know, killed and scaled and chopped up in pieces and canned and sold on a grocery store shelf. And that's the kind of the myth of this. You see this, you know, every time I go to Stratford, I always marvel at the little pork shop. You know, on Highway 8, you go by the little pork shop, and it's where they sell, like, you know, southwestern Ontario is full of pork farms, and they have, you know, you buy pork chops and sausages and stuff. And there's a little plaster pig outside. He's got a chef's hat on. He's got a fork in one trotter, and he's got a knife in the other. And it so much suggests he's not only happy to serve, he's happy to be served. You know, that there is this kind of notion of come and get me. And the media, I think, is very much part of this. Whenever, you know, an animal gets loose from a truck that's on its way to the abattoir, there's always amusing film on the 6 o'clock news about, you know, runaway pig on the 401. And, you know, oh, he doesn't want to go to that little piggy didn't want to go to market, you know, and there's kind of amusing voiceovers by the news guys. And it's this idea that somehow, even in their last desperate trip, they're there to amuse us. And they like to amuse us. They like that pig doesn't want to be caught, you know. And I think it's very necessary. I mean, I think the most recent example of this, one of the most outrageous, was the IKEA monkey. You know, which, I mean, happily, at least that poor little critter has wound up as good as it gets. He's at the storybook sanctuary. But, you know, this little, everybody knows the story. I think he got out of the car, and you've got to wonder why, in the parking lot at IKEA in his little faux shearling coat, you know, this little capuchin monkey, I think he was. And this loony woman who seems to think that having a young monkey, you know, is going to be a great lifetime proposition. I mean, doesn't seem to know the awful stories of what happens when these animals get large and start to rightfully resent being treated like little dolls and little children. But the media's treatment of this, it was the IKEA monkey. I mean, he kind of became sort of part of it because it was the IKEA parking lot. And his name was Darwin, which was kind of a comical joke, I guess, by his owner. But this, the whole, I mean, this, the real seriousness of this was really hardly dealt with. It was, again, one of these kind of what they, and I used to work in radio journalism, and these things were called brights, B-R-I-T-E-S. It wasn't even, it was spelled like light, you know, brights. And there were a whole list of them would come up from CP and BN, all the news services would churn them out in the morning. If you needed something to rip and read, you know, you had a couple of minutes to fill in the show. You ever wonder when you listen to the radio, something, where do they get these stories? They rip and read them. And a lot of them are brights about animals, you know. know, there's a dolphin who lives in such and such a theme park, and he can do this and that, and, you know, and often it involves attempted and failed escape by the animal, but it's really, really funny. And I think it's part of our need to sort of see them as functioning in this sort of sitcom relationship with us, where they try to outwit us, but, you know, they don't really want to. They really want to come home, you know, because they've got their shearling coat. And I think the way to counter this mythology, I mean, if it's possible to counter it, and I should probably wrap up actually now. Let me just sort of cut to the chase here. Yes, because I've probably gone on too long. I told Ian I would go on for like 45 minutes max, and then there would be time, lots of time for questions, which I hope there are. But let me just sort of cut to the chase here. I mean, essentially, we can use media. People who are involved in animal advocacy use media with underground footage that they get out that shows how, you know, the myth of sacrifice. I mean, there are universities who have these rituals in the spring, the end of the year of scientific endeavor, where they thank all the nameless animals who died in the lab that year. They do that at the University of Guelph and probably many others. And again, it's this idea that if you say thanks, it's okay. But the reality is, you know, is the underground footage that you see of animals and how they've been treated. The media is very useful in turning animals into characters. And it's sometimes that can operate in the animal's favor. Like, for example, a few years ago, the Animal Alliance in Toronto was involved in getting the Ontario Veterinary College, which was requiring students in one of their veterinary programs, a qualifying program for foreign vets, they had to buy for $600 a beagle, a female beagle from, you know, these suppliers who supply dogs, and, you know, raise the dog, and then spay the dog as their exam, and euthanize the dog on the table and cut the dog up. Now, you know, I mean, to me, it isn't even a good indication of whether you've successfully spayed a dog if you kill it on the spot. I mean, it'd be better to see if it, you know, the spaying worked out, if it didn't, the sutures didn't rupture, you know, or something. But it was just their protocol. And the Animal Alliance, through media threats and intimidation, I mean, the idea that there would be a campaign that would expose this. And beagles, you know, I mean, they're chosen for labs for good reasons. They're very passive, and these ones are certainly bred to be even more passive. And they're beseeching, you know, they have these wonderful faces. And so, you know, the sight of some little beagle who could have been adopted out. I mean, you know, a nice spayed female beagle. The vet would have got to qualify, and the dog would have had a happy life. That is now happening. They no longer do this. I mean, people still have to spend $600 to buy this dog as a piece of lab equipment. But nevertheless, the dog can be adopted, either by that veterinary student or put up for adoption by the public. Those are, you know, some of the ways you can counter this. I think the more we know, I mean, this is sort of controversial too, though, the idea that the more we know about how intelligent animals are, the better off they will be. One of the people I interviewed for my book was the chair of animal welfare, the first chair of animal welfare in Europe, who was at Cambridge University in England, a guy named Donald Broom, who did a few years ago an experiment called the Eureka Moment in Cows. And this is why I interviewed him, because I read about this long before I was going to do this book, and I thought it was so interesting. He had two identical Friesian heifer cows, and one of them, they both were allowed access to a place where you would push a button and a door would open and there'd be food. And with one of the cows in the set of two, the door would open randomly. It had nothing to do with whether you pushed the button or not. Sometimes the cow would get food and sometimes it didn't. The other cow would get food if it pushed the button. And the cows that learned to push the button and to get the result were ecstatic, not only because they had food, but because they figured out the connection. And they also saw that they were in charge. I mean, this is what he postulates about them. And he did it all kind of physiologically by measuring EEGs and, you know, heart rates and brain waves. And the way they kicked up their heels, the way they frolicked when they had realized the connection, what he called the Eureka moment, where the cow realized, aha, this is, I've got the power. I push the button, I get the food. Yippee. And I asked him why he did this experiment. And he said, because the more we know that their consciousness is similar to ours, the better we will treat them. I think it's true, but in a limited sort of way. I mean, I think he's a welfarist. He's not a liberationist. He's not an activist. He's somebody who believes, you know, like Temple Grandin. He's very much out of the same playbook as Temple Grandin. You know, she treats them, wants them treated well at the end of their life, and he wants them treated well as they're being raised, you know, for whatever product they're going to be. But the idea, and I think we have this idea, that if we, and there's such interest now in the consciousness of animals. We're so interested in knowing how they think. And the more we think they think like us, the more we feel this kind of connection. I don't know if it's actually true. I mean, I think probably there is a greater sense of animals as important beings, the more we know about them. I'm not really sure whether, you know, we're anywhere near yet where we could be. The note, though, that I wanted to end on is I did go finally to this place in France where this ritual had taken place with Saint Guinefort the dog, which is now just a piece of farmland. And there's kind of, in fact, there were the day that I went there, and it was hard to find. But there isn't, when you get there, there's a plaque. You know, in France, there's always a plaque. It's always an historical plaque, usually with a religious connotation about something that took place on this spot. So there is a plaque that says Le Bois de Guinefort, the Woods of Guinefort. And you can actually go in there, although it's somebody's property, they didn't seem to notice or care. There was a junk refrigerator in one place. There was toilet paper, which had evidently been used by people in another spot. But there was this woods, and this was where this thing had gone on for 700 years. And it was amazing. I read the plaque and I wrote it down, I translated it. And what the plaque said was, the woods of St. Guinefort, the legend where over the centuries the masses gave themselves to practices of the Gallic mythology, worship of waters and of forest, against which Etienne of Bourbon, the inquisitor of faith, preached in the 13th century. I thought, God, you know, it's the story. It's that story. And I was very excited. And then I realized when I was writing my book, there isn't a word on that plaque that says he's a dog. Not a word. So I wrote that in my book, and I titled that final paradox, Animals Are Everywhere and Nowhere. You know, I mean, they're so important. This story lasted for 700 years. In the late 1970s, people who had been taken there as children still knew that Guinefort was a dog. Why the hell isn't he on the plaque? And a couple of years ago, I got a note from an email from a woman who had read my book and had gone to France, and gone and found the woods, which I'd like to believe I made easier to find, because, you know, I'll tell you, Jean-Claude Schmitt did not make it easy. And she said, she wrote me an email, and she said, I just wanted you to know the sign we saw marking the woods looks like it's been updated since you were there, as if a sticker had been placed over the original plaque. I attached a picture. And sure enough, you know, these plaques are sort of like pewter or some kind of dull metal, and with inscribed, you know, sort of Gothic writing, and usually the first letter is painted a color, and yeah. And it's true. I mean, this was a fresh kind of sheet had been put over it. And in English, it now says, in this place, over the centuries, people came to pray to a holy greyhound to cure their children. In the 13th century, the inquisitor Etienne of Bourbon preached against this cult, which was based on an even older story, yet the practice continued into the 20th century. So I'm sure it wasn't my book that changed all this. I don't think the French even know there is such a book. But it's interesting, and how moved I was that the dog, you know, finally got billing on this plaque. You know, he was St. Guinefort. Le Bois de St. Guinefort was all about him. But it is still, you know, that idea, you know, that they're, even in the processes where they're so important, which is practically everything we do, animals are so totally taken for granted. And their involvement and participation is so seldom requested, it's just assumed. So that's essentially what I came here to say. And I'm happy to talk further about this or have questions or anything.
That's great.
Sure.